This is the only inspired book. And as such, we need to start with God's Word and then critically evaluate the world around us. In asking or answering the question, how old is the earth, the first place that we need to start is right here in the Bible.
Greetings, YouTube misfits, miscreants, malcontents, and misanthropes. Claire's here again with another episode of Creation Geology. Our subject today is Brad Harrub, who has a legitimate PhD in anatomy. He is nevertheless wholly ignorant of the fossil record. But of course, that doesn't stop him from perpetually bloviating on the subject in the service of Jesus. Brad may be one of the more pathetically naive creationists we come across, credulously accepting anything as evidence in support of his point of view. No matter how suspect the source, no matter how dodgy the evidence, Brad will eventually make a video about it.
When you really evaluate the evidence, you recognize the fact that there's big problems with the evolutionary timeline.
Do tell.
If you find a trilobite, it's an index fossil that supposedly that layer of dirt is one of the oldest around. So according to the evolutionary theory, trilobites lived 500 to 600 million years ago.
Actually, they're a very long-lived group of arthropods. The first ones appear in the fossil record about 540 million years ago. Most groups go extinct about 375 million years ago. And then the final few groups go extinct at the end of the Permian about 250 million years ago.
Eventually giving rise to fish.
I told you Brad didn't know anything about the fossil record. The separate evolutionary lines leading to arthropods and vertebrates probably split sometime in the very late Precambrian, and the earliest example of a vertebrate is actually contemporaneous with mid-Cambrian trilobites.
In 1969, a gentleman by the name of William Meister, he was out looking for trilobite fossils. And he found two trilobites embedded in the sandal print of a human being.
I told you Brad would buy anything. What that rock actually represents is a concretion, an agglomeration of the cementing material of the rock from whence it came. It's from the Wheeler Formation, which is chocked full of concretions that form all sorts of weird shapes.
Folks, with one fossil, you have effectively wiped away 500 to 600 million evolutionary years. The gentleman who owns that particular fossil, he shared with me, he said, evolutionists have offered him over $2 million and have pretty much bluntly told him all they want to do is destroy it.
I think I just did, Brad.
How did life get out of the sea and onto land? Their answer was a creature called the coelacanth. They found some fossils that had these funny little front-lobed fins.
Here's a fossil of one of the funny little fins that Brad's talking about.
They assumed that those were like little arms and that this guy crawled out of the water onto the beach.
Brad's grotesque ignorance on the fossil record is again on display. No one has ever claimed that coelacanths could haul themselves up onto the beach. Rather, it's that coelacanths as a group were the ancestors of amphibians.
They dated him 325 to 410 million years. The coelacanth didn't live 325 to 410 million years ago. They're very much still living today.
Brad is, of course, referring to the modern coelacanth species Latimeria chalumnae, first discovered in 1939. That was an astonishing discovery because there weren't any coelacanths in the fossil record after the late Cretaceous. But you see, Latimeria, as I stated, is a modern species. There are no fossils of Latimeria in the fossil record. There isn't the coelacanth in the fossil record. It's an entire order of fish. Specifically, coelacanths belong to the class Sarcopterygii and the order Coelacanthiformes. Calling it the coelacanth is like saying the carnivore for the entire order of Carnivora. It's ridiculous. Coelacanths were a large and very diverse group during the Paleozoic. They gradually declined during the Mesozoic, and everyone thought they'd gone extinct until a single genus, Latimeria, was discovered in 1939.
January 2005, American researchers discovered a fossilized mammal that had a dinosaur in its belly. Folks, remember the evolutionary timeline. According to that theory, mammals didn't come into the picture until millions of years later, and yet we've got a mammal that was eating a dinosaur.
Would someone consider getting Brad Harrub's address and sending him a children's book about the fossil record so that he can at least familiarize himself with the basics? Brad, I hate to break it to you, sugar britches, but the earliest mammals and the earliest dinosaurs appear roughly at the same time in the fossil record.
Evolutionists would have us believe that pterodactyls, pteranodons, that they lived 65 million years ago, that they died out with the dinosaurs. I want us to go all the way back to the 5th century BC. Herodotus said, "There's a place in Arabia to which I went on hearing of some winged serpents."
Would this be the same Herodotus that claimed there were dog-faced human beings and giant gold-excavating ants?
"And when I arrived there, I saw bones and spines of serpents in such quantities as it would be impossible to describe." He knew that these flying reptiles were real.
Brad, who the hell knows what he was shown, if he was shown anything? I mean, his credibility is suspect. And it isn't like he claims to have seen living pterosaurs. He claims to have been shown some bones, which for all I know were pterosaur fossils. During the Mesozoic, when the pterosaurs lived, Saudi Arabia was mostly under shallow sea. So it wouldn't be surprising if the ancients weren't familiar with pterosaur fossils. Brad goes on to share his credulous remonstrations concerning the ancient Jewish historian Josephus.
The same historian who wrote about a man named Jesus Christ being crucified by Pilate is also writing about flying reptiles?
Josephus. Got my copy right here. And by the way, before we get back to the pterosaurs, the bits in Josephus concerning Jesus and Pilate are generally conceded to be forgeries inserted by Christians centuries after Josephus was in the cold, cold ground. And as for his bits about flying reptiles, well, I've read that, and this is a folkloric history of the Jewish people. He's relating an anecdote about Moses. He's not claiming to have seen flying reptiles.
Friends, what does that do to the evolutionary theory?
Well, first of all, I'm not your friend, and second of all, it doesn't do a damn thing, you credulous numpty.
Or maybe somebody could explain to me the discovery of Dr. Samuel Hubbard. Etched into those canyon walls, there were pictures that had taken men literally hours to carve out. There was buffalo, sheep, dinosaurs, oxen, men. I want to show you a picture of exactly what Dr. Hubbard found, and I hate to be the one to tell you, but it's an awfully good representation of a dinosaur we now know existed called the Edmontosaurus.
And I hate to tell you, but that squiggle could be damn near anything. It might be an eagle, like this petroglyph. And that crude, wildly inaccurate drawing on the right was prepared by Eric Hovind's porcine partner, Paul Taylor. This is more likely an accurate portrayal of Edmontosaurus, a facultative biped that mostly spent time on all fours.
Or maybe somebody could explain to me the Buddhist temple in Cambodia, 800 years old. The man who had built this particular temple, he carved things intricately, like, for instance, a monkey. Or he carved a deer. He also carved dinosaurs. Dinosaurs so specific that you can look at it and tell precisely what type of dinosaur it is.
Brad says it's a stegosaur. To me, it could just as well be a chameleon.
Is there compelling evidence of dinosaur-like creatures in this book? Look now at the behemoth which I made along with you. He eats grass like an ox. See now, his strength is in his hips. His power's in his stomach muscles. He moves his tail like a cedar. The sinews of his thighs are tightly knit. His bones are like beams of bronze. His ribs are like bars of iron. He is chief in the ways of God.
Again, it could be almost anything. Could be an elephant, could be an aurochs. But Brad says no.
The text says, he moveth his tail like a cedar. So let me ask you. Elephant's tail? Does that look like a cedar?
Very compelling, I'm sure, Brad, but you kind of skipped over a line. Let's go back for a moment.
He moveth his tail like a cedar. The sinews of his stones are wrapped together.
Sinews of his stones. Now, what do you suppose stones refers to? Sweet cheeks, I do believe that testicles like that are unique to mammals. And I would expect somebody with a doctorate in anatomy to be familiar with that simple truth.
Blinded by the lights, wrapped up like a deuce under the runner in the night. Blinded by the lights.